Good evening to all. I welcome you all to the 12th online lecture of the course Experimental Methods in Thermal Engineering. In our previous lecture, we had discussion on the measurement of viscosity. In this particular lecture, we will be talking about the surface tension. Okay. So let me start. Okay. So let me start first with the definition of surface tension of pure liquids. Okay. So it's a well-known fact that if we are having any molecules which is actually in the bulk of the liquid, that will be having different forces association in comparison to that of a molecule which is actually adjacent to the interface. Okay. Similarly, we also know that if we are having very small bubbles or drops, I can say in general small fluid particles, so these will be of spherical nature, and as their volume will keep on increasing and it is influenced by the external forces such as gravitational forces, then only their shape will be distorted. Okay. So if you just start with the fundamental idea of surface tension, so we can over here start with the fundamental definition of surface tension, which is actually proposed by Gibbs. So Gibbs had stated that if we are having a system and if we are measuring the energy content of that system with, and we are considering our system such that it is having some interface also, okay, and then we consider a situation that our system does not involve now interface, and then we take the sum of all the energies. Now if we take the difference of energy when we were having interface also involved in our system, and if we consider that now in the second situation we are not having interface, and then if we take the subtraction of the total energy content of the two, that is something which will be giving us nothing but our surface tension. Okay, so that is the very basic idea of surface tension. Now one important point I would like to highlight over here, that the value of surface tension remains constant irrespective of its volume. Okay, so we may have some situation where our drop is of 1 mm diameter. In another situation, it may have diameter of 5 mm, 10 mm, or 20 mm. So irrespective of the volume or diameter of the drop or a fluidic particle, what we will be having, we will be having the constant value of surface tension. Particularly at the molecular level, the value of surface tension is actually affected by the size. So that is something which is beyond the scope of our this particular course. Okay, so now let us try to look more into the concept of surface tension with the help of one another example. Okay, so in another example, what we are having, we have taken one infinite long fluid element. So what we are having, nothing but an infinite long fluid element we are having. Now if we cut this fluid element at any particular location, and then what we will be getting, this basically this infinite fluid element is now actually splitted into two semi infinite fluid elements. Okay, and now what we have done, once we have actually sliced this infinite fluid element, we have also slightly separated it so that there should not be any interaction between the two semi-infinite fluid elements which now we have got. Okay, so what will be happening basically, while we were having this identical infinite fluid element, in that case there was at particular at the location of this slice, we were having some cohesive forces in between the subsequent molecules which were adjacent to this particular plane. Okay, and now what we have done, we have actually created some additional surfaces, and now these surfaces are nothing but exposed to some another surrounding fluid. Okay, so we may consider for example air. So now because of this, what has happened, now if we consider that nothing but EC is our cohesion energy per unit area. Okay, so EC I am calling as nothing but cohesion energy per unit surface area, whatever we are having. Okay, So what you can see over here, nothing but we have created that surface has actually created two new interfaces, and at each interfaces we are calling now our surface energy per unit area as nothing but sigma 1. Okay, so over here we are having sigma 1, and then another surface also we are having sigma 1. So I can clearly say that if my EC was the total energy of cohesion per unit area, that is nothing but equal to now 2 times of sigma 1. Okay, so this is one very important point, that sigma 1 surface tension coefficient is nothing but energy of cohesion divided by 2 when we are considering energy of cohesion per unit surface area. Okay, then one more example, let us try to see. Let us consider that we are having one frame. Okay, so this is our frame which is having 3 rigid bars, and we are having one side of this frame, so particularly this side, this is nothing but a movable side. Okay, and in this frame what we are having in between this frame, actually we are having nothing but a fluid film over here. So let us consider we are having some film of fluid over here. Okay, so what ultimately will be happening over here, when we will be displacing this rod, say we are displacing it through certain distance d, okay, and we are subjecting it to some force F. Okay, so obviously at this particular interface we are nothing but having the contact in between this surface and our fluid, so that fluid will be having some surface tension force which will be acting over here. Okay, and as we will be having some thickness of the frame, so obviously we will be having the formation of nothing but two interfaces. Now if we consider that whatever the portion of the frame we are displacing and it is in contact with the fluid, let us consider that L is the length of this particular portion of the frame. So in that case what will be happening, our force into displacement, that will be nothing but our work done, and this work done is we are having over here. Now if we try to relate the force with our surface tension, that is nothing but will be equal to sigma 1 times L. Now L, we are having now two interfaces because one on the top side and one on the bottom side, so that's why I can write over here 2 times L. Okay, so from here I can simply write that my surface tension coefficient is also nothing but equal to whatever the force we are having over here and divided by whatever length we are having. Okay, so from here we can see that the units of surface tension is nothing but newtons per meter. Okay, and in CI in CGS you can see over here that will be nothing but our dm per centimeter, and if you convert it into the basic dimensions you will be finding surface tension units as nothing but kg per second square. Okay, and normally when we measure the surface tension, it is actually the common approach is to represent the surface tension in the form of millinewtons per meter. Okay, so that is a common notation which is mainly used experimentally while we measure the value of surface tension. Okay, then now let us also try to discuss that what is the temperature dependence of surface tension. So obviously when the temperature close to the interface will be changing, there will be change in the value of the surface tension also. Okay, so over here we'll start with one idea that let us consider initially what we are having, say some temperature T, and then we are heating this liquid, and let us consider at present, so we can take any random liquid also. Okay, so we are having some liquid at temperature T, and then we are heating this liquid, and we are heating till its temperature is reaching to the critical temperature. Okay, so you all have studied the thermodynamics where we are having properties of pure substance. We know that above the critical point what will be happening, nothing but we will be having no interfacial boundary in between the liquid and vapor. Okay, why? Because above the critical point we are not able to differentiate in between the liquid phase and the vapor phase. So it means whatever the interface was there in between the liquid and vapor, below critical point, above the critical point, that interface will be actually vanishing. Okay, because we will not be able to differentiate in between the liquid and vapor above the critical point. So we can say that till critical point there is existence of some physical boundary or some interface in between the liquid and the vapor, and above the critical point, as this interface is vanishing, so obviously if we are not having any interface, there will not be any surface tension. So it means we can clearly say that above critical temperature, if our temperature is greater than critical temperature, the value of surface tension coefficient will be zero. Okay, so considering this formulation, some semi empirical correlations has been developed to relate the temperature dependence of surface tension. Okay, so there is no such well established theoretical formulation derived which relates the dependence of surface tension and temperature, but considering the fact that above critical point there will not be any interface existing, so considering this fact, the surface tension has been related to temperature. So one of the equation which has been given by Bose, you can see it is sigma 1 into v to power 2 by 3 is nothing but equal to C times Tc minus T, where this Tc is nothing but the critical temperature of the liquid for which we are trying to measure the surface tension. Okay, and V over here is nothing but molar volume in meter cube, and C is a constant, and for many of the liquids the value of this constant is approximately equal to 2.1 into 10 to power minus 4 joule per Kelvin. Okay. Apart from this equation, another equation has been given by van der Waals. So that equation tells that surface tension sigma 1 can be related to sigma naught into 1 minus T by Tc to power n, where we are having nothing but sigma naught is also a constant, and that is typically relates to the liquids, and n value of n is equal to nothing but 11/9 for many of the organic liquids. Okay, so based on these values of constants, if we are determining for particular and if we are taking their then at temperature we can determine the value of surface tension. Okay, then one more concept now we are having. This particular concept is actually related to the surface tension of liquid solutions. Okay, so majority of the times you will be finding that when we are doing some experiments related to the fluids and thermals, we are not dealing with the pure liquids, rather we are having some mixtures of liquids and mixture of some solvent and solute. We have to actually employ such type of solutions in our systems. Okay, so under such circumstances, what will be happening? There will be a change in the surface tension of the final solution, whatever we will be obtaining. So now let us try to see for different type of situations that what will be happening to the surface tension. Okay, so at present we are considering that our solvent is nothing but water. Okay, so for 0% weight concentration of the solute, you can see the value of surface tension is close to 72, because we know for water surface tension is nothing but 72.86 millinewtons per meter. Okay, so you can see that in our plots, when we are having 0% weight percent, at that time our at that point our value of surface tension is nothing but equal to 72 millinewtons per meter. Okay, then now first what we have seen, we have to see that how our addition of solute is actually changing the interfacial characteristics. Okay, so it's observed or it's developed from the fundamental theories that if our solute stays on the interface, in that case what it will be doing, it will be actually decreasing the surface tension of our medium, and if our solute is actually mixed in the bulk of the liquid, in that case what will be happening, our surface tension will be remaining almost unaffected. Okay, so you can see over here in first example what we are having, we are adding some NaCl solution into our water, and for different weight percentage you can see there is slight increase in surface tension of the mixture. So from this we can conclude that because our fundamental understanding says that if surfactant particles stays at the interface, then what will be happening, value of surface tension will be decreasing. If these are mixed in the bulk of the solution, in that case our surface tension will remain almost unaffected. Okay, so that's what we are able to observe over here in this particular first graph. What is happening when we have added the NaCl for even up to the maximum weight percentage of 30%, you can see there is a very slight increase in surface tension of the mixture. Okay, so particularly we can see that in this type of mixture, what is happening, whatever the salt we are adding, NaCl we are adding, that is actually being mixed in the bulk of the liquid. Okay, then another type of solute we may have, some organic solute. So for example, in second situation you can see now we are adding propanol in our water. Okay, so in particular these organic solutes, what happens, these prefers to concentrate at the interface. So as the organic solute will be staying at the interface, so because of that there will be significant drop in our surface tension. So you can see that up to 10% of the loading of propanol, we can see that there is a significant decay in the value of surface tension of water. And as we have further increased the loading of propanol, the rate of decay has actually slightly decreased, and finally we are actually approaching towards the surface tension of the propanol, because majority of our interface now will be actually covered with the solute itself. Okay, so why this happens generally, because organic solutes contains some molecules, and these molecules are nothing but of hydrophobic nature. So because of the hydrophobic nature of these organic some molecules in organic solutes, what will be happening, these solutes actually will be trying to move away from the bulk of the liquid, and these will be facing or staying adjacent to the interface. Okay, then there is one another type of substance also, solute also. So now what we are having, we are having hydrophobic organic molecule, but now we are having some polar part also together with our hydrophobic organic molecule. So in that case, what will be happening, we are having some dominant hydrophobic part and we are having polar part. So both these things are actually together. So particularly for this type of molecules also, solubility in the bulk is very, very small, and because of that, majority of these molecules tend to adsorb mostly at the surface. Okay, so such type of molecules are particularly referred to as surface active agents or surfactants. Okay, so what will be happening when we will be adding the surfactant, very minute addition of the surfactant leads to drastic drop in the surface tension values of the solution. Okay, so one example is given over here for CTAB surfactant. So this is nothing but cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide in phosphate phosphate buffer solution. So when we are adding this particular solution, you can see over here, earlier we were having the weight percentage of the order of 10%, 20%. Now we are having weight percent of the order of 10^-4%, 10^-2%. Okay, so you can see that we are having, upon addition of very small volume of this surfactant into our liquid, there is actually drastic decrease of the surface tension of the liquid. Okay, and after certain concentration of the solute, we will be finding that our surface tension value is actually remaining unaffected. Okay, so this particular value of particular concentration of the solute above which there is no change in surface tension value, this is known as critical micelle concentration. Okay, why? Because if we are going above this, there will not be any increase or any change of the surface tension value. And why this happens? Because above this, whatever the molecules were there which were causing the surface tension to decrease, these molecules aggregate in the bulk of the liquid and they form some structure. That particular structure is called as actually micelle. So one of the spherical micelle structure is shown over here, you can see over here. So in this particular type of structure, what happens, molecules arrange themselves in such a fashion so that the hydrophobic part will be actually remaining at the center, and in the surroundings we will be having other molecules which are actually not of hydrophobic nature. Okay, so what it will be doing, it will try to minimize the interaction of this type of structure, will try to minimize the interaction of hydrophobic molecules with the water, and these can easily stay in the bulk of the water. Now, apart from this spherical type of structure, there can be another geometrical orientations also. So that is particularly the part of material research. I have just included this portion for your understanding. Okay, when we are coming into, or when we are taking our liquid solutions in our experiments of fluids and thermal. So just for your understanding, I have included this portion. Okay, now we are having some correlations also for relating the surface tension upon inclusion of solutes. So you can see over here, when we are having the low concentration addition of the solute, in that case, we can see that surface tension sigma 1 can be obtained for the final liquid solution with the help of this relation, which is sigma 1 equal to sigma naught minus RT into gamma infinity ln of 1 plus C by B. So over here you can see that sigma naught is the surface tension of the pure solvent, R is universal gas constant, C is nothing but molar concentration of the solute, and gamma naught and B are two empirical constants which are to be determined by the best fit of the experimental data. So over here, one important thing I would like to highlight over here, this gamma infinity is nothing but it represents the saturated solute concentration at interface. Okay, so this is nothing but this gamma infinity represents what is the saturated solute concentration at the interface, means beyond which if you keep on adding the interface, here will not be any tension value. Okay. We are having one more relation which is given by Connors and Wright. So this is also known as Connors and Wright equation, and this is applicable for high concentration of the solute. So you can see over here in this particular equation what we are having, x we are having as molar fraction of the solute, and alpha and beta are nothing but two empirical constants. So you can see that when your value of x is zero, in that case, we will be finding that our surface tension is nothing but equal to surface tension of the pure solute. And when our value of x is 1, then it will be becoming identical to that of the base liquid. Okay, so that is nothing but you can see from the value of x, we are getting the this first term over here, which is giving us, depending upon the value of x, it is giving us the value of surface tension of the solute and solvent. Okay. Apart from surface tension, there is one more very, very important concept, and it is nothing but identical to that of the surface tension, but it is having some different name. Okay, and this particular name is referred to as interfacial tension. Okay, so the term interfacial tension is used when we are having the contact of the liquid with any other fluid other than the gaseous phase. For example, it is in contact with another immiscible liquid, or it may be in contact with some solid surface. Okay, so for this type of arrangement, we call our interfacial energy as nothing but our interfacial tension. Okay, so one example I have included over here, where we are having nothing but two semi-infinite fluid elements, and these two different semi-infinite fluid elements are actually interacting with each other. So because of their interaction, obviously what we will be having, because the molecules in this particular portion are different than the molecules over here, so these two are having nothing but what type of forces? Adhesive forces. Okay, so here we will be having nothing but our adhesive forces between the molecules across the interfacial boundary. Okay, so let us consider that sigma AB is the initial energy stage. It means it is nothing but the interfacial tension between fluid A. I am considering above one as fluid A and bottom one as fluid B. Now, once again, what we have done, we have sliced this interface, and we have actually converted it into two separate fluid elements. So obviously now what will be the final surface tension of fluid B will be sigma B, and for A it will be sigma A. Okay, so what we have done basically, sigma AB was nothing but the initial interfacial tension, and then we have supplied some amount of work, and that amount of work is nothing but equal to that of the energy which is associated with the adhesion between the molecules. Okay, and when we have supplied that equivalent amount of work, it has generated two interfaces, and the final interfacial energies of these interfaces are nothing but as sigma A plus sigma B. Okay, so from here I can write that my sigma AB is nothing but equal to sigma A plus sigma B minus EA. So over here this sigma AB is nothing but interfacial tension. Okay, so this term is my interfacial tension, and sigma A and sigma B are the surface tension of individual fluids A and B, and EA is the energy of adhesion per unit area. Okay, so this is the energy of adhesion per unit area. So it means if we have to determine the interfacial tension, we should know about this energy of adhesion EA. Okay, so how to determine this energy of adhesion? Let us now try to see. So for this also, once again, there is no fundamental means based on the first principle, there is no theoretical relation which is available. So we are once again having some semi-empirical correlations available. Okay, but before going to these correlations, let me just briefly tell you about one more concept. So when we are having surface tension, so this surface tension value actually in a fluid is mainly because of the two contributions. One is because of dispersive forces, and another is because of the polar forces. Okay, so dispersive forces are nothing but, these are also known as the van der Waals forces, and these type of forces are associated with the molecules due to the fluctuations of charges at the molecular and atomic levels. Okay, and polar forces are in the molecules because of these are nothing but the Coulombic interactions, because of the permanent dipoles or certain dipoles which are actually induced because of the more electronegative elements. Okay, so we can take the example of two elements, and we can comment that where we will be having polar interactions or not. Okay, so for example, first if we take a CO2 molecule, in case of CO2 molecule, we will be having some double bond, covalent bond over here between the carbon and the oxygen atoms. Okay, and what we know that nothing but our oxygen is more electronegative in comparison to carbon. So because of its more electronegative nature, what it will do, it will try to attract these bond electrons towards its side. Okay, so what, because of that, what will be happening, because it is now trying to attract the bond electrons, so it will attract more number of electrons in comparison to whatever are required for having the neutral state. So because of that, there will be development of some partial negative charge over the oxygen atom. Okay, and there will be some development of some positive charge, partial positive charge on the carbon atom. Okay, so now you can see there will be some dipole which will be existing between this carbon and oxygen bond over here, and one dipole over here between the carbon and oxygen bond. So the existence of these dipoles is basically leads to the occurrence of polar forces. But in this particular type of arrangement, you can see over here, the carbon and oxygen atoms are arranged in such a fashion so that these, both these dipoles, because they are having same magnitude and opposite direction, so these will be actually cancelling out. Now if you take the another arrangement of water molecule, so in case of water molecule, what happens, we will be having oxygen, and then we will be having over here hydrogen atoms, something like this. Now once again, oxygen is more electronegative, so we will be having some delta negative charge over here and delta positive charge over the hydrogen atoms. Okay, so there will be one dipole like this and one dipole like this. Now, because of these two dipoles, both will be actually contributing to some resultant dipole, and finally we will be finding some net dipole which will exist in our water molecule. Okay, so like this, and particularly because of the occurrence of this partial negative and partial positive charge on the oxygen and hydrogen atoms in water molecules, there is the formation of hydrogen bonding in the water molecule. So we can consider that hydrogen bond is also nothing but a contributor of the surface tension, but in which category it will be going? It will be going in the category of polar forces. Whereas if we are having any random fluctuations, random charge fluctuations in our molecules and atoms, so because of these random charge fluctuations, whatever the forces will be existing at the interface, these forces are nothing but of dispersive type nature. Okay, so dispersive forces always exist in all the type of the fluids, whereas the polar, particularly the polar type of forces, will be applicable to some particular molecular arrangements only. Okay, so it means that the total surface tension will be actually coming from the two factors. However, the fluids where we are not having any polar effect, there the entire surface tension will be because of the dispersive nature of the forces. Okay, now based on this, you can see over here that Girifalco and Good in 1957, they have actually developed one correlation which tells us about the energy of the adhesion. So energy of adhesion is nothing but 2 times phi square root of sigma A into sigma B. So over here this phi is actually called as the liquid, it is some correction factor, and it is employed experimentally measured for the liquid fluid systems, and its values are found in the range of 0.6 to 1.2. Okay, so later on, based on the concept of dispersive forces and the hydrogen bonding, Fox have actually considered that sigma is nothing but equal to sigma dispersive plus sigma because of the hydrogen bonds. And what they have done, now one important point we have to remember over here, that work of adhesion between the non-similar phases mainly depend only on the non-polar interaction. Why? Because polar interactions are particularly contributing in between the molecules of the similar type. Okay, so when we are talking about hydrogen bond will always form only between the water molecules. Okay, so if we are having water and kerosene in contact with each other, so there will not be any formation of hydrogen bond in between the water molecule and the kerosene molecule. So because of that, one important point we have to consider over here, that while we will be talking about adhesive forces mainly will be coming into picture because of the dispersive parts. Okay, so that's why considering this idea of surface tension constitution, this adhesion energy is actually represented in the form of only in the form of component of adhesion. Okay, then apart from that, Owens and Bendit in 1969, they have also generalized this approach of polar, and in this polar contribution, actually they have included the effect of polar contribution also. So you can see over here now, our adhesion energy has become nothing but 2 times of square root sigma AD sigma BD plus of sigma AT and sigma BT. So what they have basically done, they have also included the polar part also into the estimation of the adhesion energy. Okay, now if we compare particularly these two equations, the very first equation which I have shown over here and this last equation, so based on these, particularly these two equations, what you can do, you can estimate the value of phi. How? If we just divide, if we equate the value of EA and divide the remaining term, so we will be finding the value of phi as nothing but equal to sigma A D into sigma B D divided by sigma A sigma B whole square root plus the same similar term for nothing but our polar component. Okay, now let us take one example. So what we are having in our example, we are considering that we are having water, and for water, say our dispersion contribution divided by total surface tension is nearly equal to 0.3. Okay, and now if we are having the interaction of this water with some another fluid, and that another fluid is having actually non-polar liquid. So for that, sigma p is nothing but equal to zero. So because of that, what will be happening? The second part of this correction factor will become zero, and we will be finally getting that the total surface tension for second liquid. So over here, what we are doing? We are nothing but for water, we are writing sigma d by sigma is nothing but equal to 0.3, and for second liquid, we are saying that sigma p is zero. So it's nothing but a non-polar liquid. So if it's a non-polar liquid, then in that case, what will be happening? The total surface tension B of the second liquid will be equal to its dispersive component. Okay, so sigma B D. So because of that, now if we calculate the value of phi, so we will be having sigma A D divided by sigma A is nothing but equal to 0.3 multiplied by sigma B D divided by sigma B, that is nothing but equal to 1, and the second part, polar part, is becoming zero because sigma b p is equal to zero. So we will be finding the value of phi as nothing but 0.3 raised to power 1 by 2, which is nearly equal to 0.55. So from here you can see that this minimum value of phi from the theory it has, or from the this correction factor, whatever we have derived now, from this it has comes equal to 0.55. Whereas experimentally observed value was nothing but 0.6. So it means this is very close to the experimentally observed value. One more important point I would like to highlight over here. So from this theoretical relation, you can see the maximum value of phi will be nothing but equal to 1. Okay, so 1 will be the maximum value of phi. However, from our experimental knowledge, as reported in the literature, it has been stated that value of phi can go up to 1.2. So it means whatever this correction factor correlation we are having over here, it is not very accurate. However, it is a good approximation in order to find out the value of energy of adhesion. Okay. Then phi I am representing over here for a polar liquid A with a non-polar liquid B. So that is nothing but I have just now stated you that if we simplify this equation, we will be finding value of phi as equal to sigma A dispersive part divided by sigma A whole square root. Okay, so that will be applicable if we are having the combination of a polar and a non-polar liquid. Okay, now let us try to see the implications of the surface or interfacial tensions. So what we have done, just for your understanding, I have first taken a two-dimensional interface, and in this particular two-dimensional interface, say if I have to determine its radius of curvature at this location, so what I will do, I will try to fit a circle, and that circle I'll try to fit nothing but with three tangent points to the circle, and these points should be very close to the point at which we are actually trying to find out the radius of curvature. Okay, and then that also I have once again determined for another this situation or another point on this curve. So you can see over here, in one side we are having it is the circle is actually on the top portion of the interface, and in the second part it is actually below the interface. So what will be happening, depending upon the sign convention, one side we will be having positive radius of curvature, and another side we will be having negative radius of curvature. Okay, so when we are having actually complex interfaces, for the complex interfaces, what we do, we try to determine its curvature, and that curvature is actually related to the pressure difference across the interface with the help of one equation, one famous equation, and that particular equation is actually known as Young-Laplace equation. Okay, so this is just for your revision only, because you have already studied these concepts in your course on fluid mechanics. So what we are having, Young-Laplace equation, which relates the pressure drop, pressure difference across the interface to the surface tension term. Okay, so how it relates, let us first try to see. So let us consider a random three-dimensional curve. So we are having one three-dimensional surface over here, and in this particular surface, if we have to define the mean curvature of for this surface, so what we have to do, nothing but we have selected some point. So this is the point over here I have taken, and I have actually fitted a circle over here. Okay, and the radius of this circle is nothing but equal to r1, and this particular radius is known as principal radius of curvature. Okay, so this is called as principal radius of curvature. Then one more curve I have fitted over here, and this is giving us another radius r2. So this is also another principal radius of curvature. Okay, so what we need to do, first thing is, why we are calling this as principal radius of curvature? Because we are selecting the planes in such a fashion so that these planes are nothing but at 90 degree angle to each other. So we are considering the orthogonal planes over here. So because of that, whatever the radius we are obtaining, that radius we are calling it as the principal radius of curvature. Okay, so while we are defining the mean curvature for any random three-dimensional surface, one important point you have to remember, that it, with the help of only two principal radius of curvature we can define. But the only one thing you have to remember is, why we are calling this principal radius of curvature, when we will be selecting the planes at which we are trying to obtain the radius of curvature, the angle between the two planes should be 90 degrees. So over here you can see one plane I have selected over here like this, and this is my another plane. So you can see between these two planes we are having nothing but 90 degree angle. Okay, so once we are having the individual radius of curvature, then we can define the mean curvature h as nothing but 1 by r1 plus 1 by r2 divided by 2. So from here I will be finally getting that my 2h is nothing but equal to 1 divided by r1 plus 1 divided by r2. Okay, so this is the relationship in between the curvature and the principal radius of curvature. Okay, mean curvature and principal radius of curvature. Okay, so then from this Young Laplace equation, we know that Pi minus P naught is nothing but equal to sigma times curvature. Okay, so our curvature will be coming as 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. So we are having now 2 times of sigma H over here. So I can write it nothing but sigma times 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2, because my 2H is equal to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Okay, so from this equation, one important point we can see over here, that whatever be the surface profile, irrespective of the surface profile and irrespective of the liquid on the inner side, what will be happening, always we will be having inside pressure more in comparison to that of the outside pressure. Okay, and particularly if we are having very infinite long interface, for that infinite long interface, what happens basically, the pressure, particularly in the equilibrium situation, the pressure of the interface or pressure close to the adjacent sides of the interface, it will be actually identical. Okay, and apart from that, if we are having any type of arrangement between the interfaces, irrespective of the type of the fluid, always we will be having inside pressure more in comparison to that of the outside pressure. Okay, now let us try to apply this equation for a spherical liquid element. So for a spherical liquid element, what will be happening, because sphere will be having nothing but symmetry in both the principal planes, so because of that, the individual radius of curvature r1 will be equal to r2, which will be equal to r, nothing but the radius of the sphere. So because of that, if you substitute over here, you will be finding that the difference of pressures is nothing but equal to 2 sigma by r. Now if we apply the same equation for our cylindrical fluid element, in case of cylindrical fluid element, what will be happening, in one side we are nothing but having infinite radius of curvature, okay, and in another side we are having radius of curvature equal to r. So particularly in this side we are having r as the radius of curvature, and along this axis we are nothing but having infinite radius of curvature, because it's a line. Okay, so because of that, what will be happening? We will be getting the value of Pi minus P naught as sigma by R, because 1 by infinity will be equal to 0. Okay. Then now let us come to our main topic, which is the part of this course, measurement of surface tension. What are the different techniques for measuring the surface tension or interfacial tension? Okay, so we are having two categorization for measuring the surface tension. First type of category comes under the heading of force methods. So in force methods, we are having drop method, ring method, and Wilhelmy-Flute method. Then in case of drop shape methods, we are having the drop pendant drop shape, then rotating cylinder, and maximum bubble pressure based methods for estimation of the surface tension. Now, one more important point I would like to highlight over here. Just if we are having a drop which is suspended from a surface, that particular type of drop is called as a pendant drop. So this I'll be using in my terminology in the subsequent slides. Okay, and if a droplet is resting on a solid surface, this particular type of droplet is called as sessile drop. Okay, so this you should know the name of the drop. When I am taking the name as pendant drop, it means drop is hanging from some solid surface, and when I am taking that considering that we are having a sessile drop, it means a drop is resting on a solid surface. Okay, so let us first try to see the very first method is drop weight method. So it's very simple, nothing but what we are having a capillary, and through this capillary some liquid is actually some drop is hanging. And this drop will be remaining attached to the capillary when its weight will be equal to the, or sorry, whenever its weight will be less in comparison to the interfacial forces. And when its weight will become exactly identical to that of the surface tension force or interfacial tension force, at that point, there will be some detachment of the drop from the surface of the capillary. Okay, so you can see this first situation is represented over here. We have considered a isolated drop and its weight is acting in downward direction, and some interfacial force will be acting when it was actually adhered to the surface of this capillary. Okay, so what we are having over here, we can relate at equilibrium, weight of the drop will be equal to the surface tension force. Now over here you can see that the cross section of the capillary will be nothing but circular, and if small r is the radius of this capillary, so small r is the radius, in that case we will be having surface tension force as 2 pi r into sigma 1. Okay, so this balances our interfacial force with the weight of the drop. But over here you can see I have included one more factor, Fw. Okay, along with the surface tension force. So this particular factor Fw is one correction factor, and why this correction factor is included, let me just explain to you. So when the drop detaches from the surface, in this perfect detachment situation, I have represented the drop profile as very flat interface, okay, which is exactly mimicking our capillary surface profile. However, in actual experimental situation, what will be happening, the drop detachment will not take place from the capillary interface. In actual experimental situation, what basically happens, if this is my capillary, there will be some drop liquid, and this drop will be forming some neck. So drop will be forming a neck-like structure over here, and this neck will be actually slightly below the exact, so over here my exact surface of capillary is actually existing, and you can see over here this neck is actually lying at some distance from the surface of the capillary. Okay, so because of that, particularly the pinch off will be happening over here. Okay, so this phenomenon of pinch off is actually very, very complex phenomenon, and if we have to exactly determine the interface profile during this detachment, we have to go for either very high speed experiments or we have to go for the numerical simulations. Okay, so what we do in order to include the correction because of this pinch off of the droplet which is happening outside the surface of the capillary, we take one correction factor, and particularly the value of this correction factor FW depends upon the size of the capillary and volume of the detached drop. Okay, so over here what we have done, we have represented the value of this FW as in the ratio of R by V to power 1/3. So over here this is the value of correction factor FW for different values of R by V to power 1/3. Okay, so this type of drop weight method is a very simple method for estimation of the surface tension. However, it is not very accurate. Why? Because we are having the pinch off dynamics associated with the droplet, which says that pinch off of the droplet or detachment of the droplet is not exactly happening from the surface of the capillary. So because of that, there will be some inaccuracies associated with this type of method. However, if we have to have some relative measure of the surface tension for different type of liquids, for that type of measurements, this is a very good, reliable and simple method. Okay, and one more point I would like to highlight over here, this method can be employed for measurement of the surface tension as well as the interfacial tension. So you can see over here, this configuration 2, in this configuration 2 we are having surrounding liquid as air, so it means we are nothing but measuring the surface tension, and when we are immersing this entire capillary inside another fluid, then we can see that we are measuring nothing but our interfacial tension. Okay, then another type of method we are having, ring method. So it is also identical to that of the drop method only, but only the mechanism is different. So in that case, what we do, we take a cylindrical ring, we take a circular cross section ring, and this circular cross section ring is actually first immersed inside the liquid, and then it is actually taken out of the liquid. So while it will come out of the liquid above the nominal surface of the liquid, it will be actually taking some liquid along with it. Okay, so what we do, we try to measure this force which is required to lift the ring out of the liquid. Okay, and this force will be nothing but equal to the weight of the ring plus the surface tension force. Now you can see over here, as we are having the circular cross section of the ring, so we will be having formation of one interface on the inner profile of the ring and one interface on the outer profile of the ring. Okay, and now if we consider that our radius of the ring, means radius of cross section of the ring, is very small in comparison to the mean radius of the ring, in that case what will be happening for both inner as well as outer surface, while we are actually measuring the interfacial size, we can consider mean radius RR only. Okay, so because of that, over here you can see that we are having a factor of 4 which is coming over here. Because if we are having a single interface, so in that case our interfacial periphery will be equal to 2 pi RR, and as we are having the interface profiles on inner and outer sides of the ring which are in contact with the liquid, so that's why we are having one factor over here. Okay, and in this particular formulation also we have included FR. So this FR is nothing but once again identical to the correction factor, because over here also the nature of detachment will not be very very smooth, it will be once again very complex. Okay, so this particular type of coefficient over here depends upon the RR, means mean radius of the ring, divided by volume of the ring to power 1/3 into RR divided by RR. So this volume VR over here, this is nothing but represents the meniscus volume of the liquid. So meniscus volume of the liquid refers to the liquid which has actually attached to the ring above the bulk surface. So particularly this portion of the liquid is something which is called as the meniscus volume. Okay, so this method is once again identical to that of the drop method, because we are over here doing the force balance, but instead of the drop now we have taken a ring. Now one advantage of ring method is that it can be easily automated, so it can be used for the automatic device development where we can actually measure the surface tension or interfacial tension, because if we are considering instead of air another fluid over here, then it may be employed for measurement of the interfacial tension. Okay, but one disadvantage of this method is that our ring should be of perfect shape. We should not have any distortions on the surface of the ring, because if we are having any distortions, then these will be leading to the inaccurate results. Okay, then another method is Wilhelmy plate method. So in case of Wilhelmy plate method, it is once again identical to that of a ring method, that we will be having a very thin plate. So you can see over here, this will be the cross section of the plate, and this thin plate is actually taken out of the liquid, and in that case what we do, whatever the force is required to move the plate, that we consider as nothing but equal to the weight of the plate plus PP, we are calling it as perimeter of this plate into surface tension. So now this method is actually the accurate out of all discussed till this point. Why? Because in this particular type of plate cross section, whenever the fluid will be detaching from the surface of the plate, that detachment will be almost of the linear nature. It means from every part of the surface we will be having the detachment. Okay, there will not be any portions that where some liquid is adhered, and in some portions where liquid is actually not in contact. Okay, so here we will be having smooth detachment in between the liquid and the plate surface. So because of that, here we do not need to include any correction factor, and particularly this method is actually very accurate method for estimation of the surface tension. Okay, so then we are having drop shape based methods, but what I will do, I'll stop at this point, and particularly the methods related to the shape of the drop, I will try to discuss in our next lecture. Okay.